Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the Star Citizen Happy Hour. I'm your host, Community Manager Jared Huckaby. And if you've never seen Happy Hour before, that's where we take a little time out of our day every single week and we play the game that we work so hard on, Star Citizen. So with me today, I'm the community manager. I'm one of the community managers. Tyler Wicken is on a well-deserved vacation. He's in the snow. I hear that he's in the snow. He's in a much better place than we are. So, Tyler, we miss you. We'll see you back here next week. But with us today, immediately to my left here, is senior writer for Star Citizen, Cloud Imperium Games, and Squadron 42, Mr. Will Weissbaum. How you doing, man?
Good to be here. I'm doing wonderfully. I'm very excited to finally be on Happy Hour. I've been watching for all these weeks, and now it's my chance to be on the other side of things, which is a lot more uncomfortable.
Yes. If you've watched Happy Hour before, we usually have our guest of honor in this chair, but Will is such an exceptional player at Star Citizen. We decided to actually put our guest on the hot seat and make him play Star Citizen today.
Yeah.
So thank you for playing with us. Also with us today, subbing in for Tyler Wicken out of our Austin, Texas studio, we have Michael Blackard. How you doing, Michael?
Doing real good. I'm really, really happy to be here. It's good to see everybody again. You might have recognized me from the December live stream. I'm wearing my same shirt. I was in the montage. So super stoked to be here. I'm really, really excited to play all sorts of things and let you guys know what all is going on.
Be honest, you only have the one shirt.
I have an Arena Commander shirt. I was telling Clifford before the show, I have an Arena Commander shirt, but this is the only shirt that I wear.
Okay.
Only one.
Why don't you stand up real quick and give us a good look at that shirt? Because I don't think
this
we've properly. Yeah, this was from our holiday live stream, the Team America. I'm a big fan of that shirt.
I love this shirt. I've got two shirts. It's Arena Commander and this one.
Yes. Yes. And last but certainly not least, our guest from the community streamer, Mr. Clifford, a.k.a. Miku. How are you doing, man?
I am doing great this evening. It has been another wonderful year of my life, being my birthday and all, and I do not feel 36.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Wow.
Now, thank you.
Is the happy birthday song still copyrighted?
No,
I thought they did that. Maybe at the end of the stream, we'll sing Clifford a happy birthday, just in case. We'll do it at the end of the stream.
That's good. Tease that to make sure that people stick around to the end for that moment.
Yeah, stick around to sing Clifford A.K. Miku a happy birthday at the end of the stream. So Clifford, you stream on Beam, is that correct?
Yes, that is correct. I stream on Beam. I used to dual stream to Twitch and Beam, but then I slowly concentrated on Beam now since Star Citizen isn't so prevalent over there. I figure, hey, I can bring something new to this streaming platform versus Twitch.
So you're a Star Citizen Beam pioneer.
Yes.
All right.
Very much so.
Well, good job. Thanks thanks for spreading the message on Beam.
No, you're welcome.
Beam.
They seem to like it. When we went to PAX South, they seemed very enthusiastic about speaking with y'all when y'all were able to give them time out of your day. So,
of course, we are broadcasting on Twitch. We do love Twitch. Yep. Thank you, Twitch. If anybody in Twitch is watching and they're like, why is he talking about Beam? We love you, Twitch. We'll never leave you. So we are on the cusp of 261. 261 is currently available on our public test servers. There's a patch cooking right now that we feel pretty confident about. So check that out later today. Could drop at any moment. From what I'm seeing, I don't have an ETA, but they're confident that another PTU patch will go out today.
Not in the middle of us playing.
Yes, hopefully not in the middle of us playing. For this broadcast, in order to avoid that, we are going to be playing on 2.6 live.
Oh.
So Will, as you are the guest of honor, we're making you play, what would you like to play first in Star Citizen?
I have a big soft spot in my heart for Last Stand.
You have a big soft spot for Last Stand?
Yeah.
Man after my own heart. Dirty elimination. No eliminations
here. 2.6, though. I'm going to have to, I've been enjoying 2.6.1 so much. I've been out on the PTU servers this week playing, so that breaks my heart a little bit. But I'll get by. I'll be okay. I'm liking the new patch, is what I'm saying.
Hey, I'll be definitely down with that also, because I kept getting killed by WTFosaurus before we went live. So,
yeah. I'm cool with either, because I test both.
So, Michael, why don't you go ahead and invite everybody into a group, and let's get going on some Star Marine. Now, Will,
Yes.
You are a senior writer.
That's correct.
For Star Citizen. We had lead writer Dave Haddock on. Why don't you tell folks at home what does a senior writer do? So for somebody, this is the first time that they're seeing.
I do everything that Dave Haddock does, just a little bit worse. Just that's my main. Dave and I and the rest of the narrative team, Adam and hey Sherry,
hi Adam, hi Sherry,
and John Schimmel, of course. So we all work together to help create the narrative of Star Citizen, and that goes anywhere from writing the dialogue that you hear, for example, in Star Marine, all the announcers, the Marine captain and the outlaw leader, as well as the computer announcer voice. We helped craft all those lines and get them recorded, and from there we also did the whole lore backstory to help the artist create the environments for this, and worked with the designer Sean on crafting those levels, and then we also do design stuff and high level stuff and come up with snack foods to populate the world, which hopefully we'll have some more coming soon, because we just did a huge big document
about
snacks
and drinks.
People
are a little tired
of
Betty's at this point. You need to give them some other food to idolize. You need other food to idolize and start.
So speaking of food, wait, is Sheehan food edible to humans?
Some of it. It's a taste thing that we've been exploring more, and hopefully we'll have come out further. We've mentioned on some of our lore posts like a really potent fermented drink that humans find almost unpalatable, but that's really popular with Sheehan. So
like kombucha.
Oh, sick kombucha booze. Burn. I kind of like kombucha.
I actually really like kombucha. Okay. I really like honeydew melon like kombucha. Yeah. Hey. Clifford, when you're ready, you should have an invite.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm in.
No, I'm not. I'm ready.
Yeah, they can't shut the game until you're ready.
There we go. There we go.
So, are you guys going to go ahead and jump into the game? Switch to our game screens here.
No, thank you for that reminder on how to do that.
So let that go. So, right off the bat, remember, folks, we do take questions from the Twitch chat. Will is a senior writer for the game. So consider questions that a writer
about
would be
a lot
able
about ship balance,
yes.
Weapon loadouts.
Yes, exactly. If you're asking when this particular ship is going to be completed in the pipeline, Will is probably not the person who's going to be able to ask.
Though we
that.
Do work on the brochure, so we do get a little insight into that. But I'm not going to say anything. So
we have a question right off the bat. It says, "How do the Sheehan feel about spicy food?"
So one idea, well. Maybe I won't get in trouble for this. Well, something that we're leaking out is that they taste foods a little bit different than we do. So, like, one of their big things is kind of different texture food more than flavor. And this is because they tend to eat more kind of fermented and rotting foods by nature. So their sense of taste isn't quite as the same as ours. So they kind of like foods that tingle or numb or feel prickly and stuff like that.
This is seriously something you guys work on? This is something that you guys develop?
Yeah.
All right. I know Michael has something special, but I want to give Clifford first shot here since he is our guest from the community. Clifford, do you have a question for Will before we jump into questions from the community?
Yeah, I'm kind of curious of how, obviously the Sheehan, and I haven't really seen a lot of their pictures of, like, their hands and their ambidextry. How does their weapon types and types of just everyday items that they use kind of different in a way of how they grip things?
So I'm gonna kind of not to talk too much about this. We're still working with design. Well, design is basically formulating what the most fun gameplay is going to be, and then we're gonna be catering our lore to kind of emphasize that. So rather than, like, we kind of work in conjunction with them and we talk about some of the things that we've been thinking about, but the actual specifics of how the weapon's gonna work is definitely being led by them to make sure that really cool, awesome gameplay.
Gotcha.
So we have some stuff cooking, but I'm gonna leave it very vague right now.
Now I want to say that Michael here came prepared. I'm gonna warn Will here. Michael, why don't you show him what you have on your desk?
Okay,
here.
So I again came prepared because I'm filling in for Tyler, which is huge shoes, unless you've actually seen him, and then he's just wearing sandals. So
huge
flip flops.
He's got huge flip flops.
So
to fill.
this is my gamepad note of all the things. So this is all 2.6.1 stuff that I'm going to talk about, and then this is all my questions for Will up here.
Okay.
So, like, the first question, because we're building a universe, like, there's people. These are people that we're dealing with. So, like, who are the pop stars? Like, who's everybody listening to? Like, who are these people? I need to know.
Have you read any of our Star Watch Short story pieces of fiction?
Maybe no. Not the
so
right
this
ones?
Is so yeah. So we have Star Watch is one of our ongoing series, which kind of gets into the pop stars, the music, the celebrities mm-hmm. of the universe. And so there's a lot of characters that we've been creating there, and we have some bands, and like figuring out the backstory behind the band that wrote the theme song for Galactic Tour, that kind of stuff, which I'm blanking on right now, but we do have a write-up lurking somewhere on that, and all that's going to be out in the world creating. Like right now in 2.6.1, you can actually see in Echo 11 some sweet band posters that just got added in for like Los Imperators, which is one of the bands, like a punk band. And
I liked Los Imperators before they were cool.
You were all over them, Jared. So yeah, there's a lot of stuff that we're working on for that.
I don't know, Juan, when you're talking about when you're talking about bands, what popped into mind was the scene of Jabba the Hutt and, you know, the aliens doing the song and music. That'd be kind of cool, actually, to see.
Like a cantina band?
Yes.
Yeah, we need some cantina bands. All right, so the game is starting.
Oh.
All right, so we have a question from the chat here.
This is really hard talking and answering and playing at the same time.
It is. Yes. And because we're a couple men down, that's why I'm here monitoring, because it's very hard to do this. I've said this a couple of times. Professional streamers, people who play the game and talk and be entertaining and informative at the same time, it is a tremendous skill, and you have much respect for me. So we have a question here. It says, I ask this every single happy hour. Maybe I'll have good luck now. Carrick? The current Carrick status is that it's on the schedule. It is not in active development at the moment, but it is on the schedule for this year, for 2017. As far as when it gets adjusted based on the other ships, sometimes the ship before it will take longer, sometimes the ship before it will go faster, but it is on the schedule for this week. But there is nothing new to report on the Carrick right now. Trust me, when that goes into production, we have heard enough questions about it. We will let you know on shows such as this. We will tell you the Carrick is in production, but until it enters production, there is no new information.
So, I agree.
So what else is that? Well, you can ask Carrick questions. There's just no information to give at this point.
I mean, it's a fun ship. Everyone.
Yeah. But again, as far as ship questions, this isn't the crew to ask, unfortunately.
Hey, look, I did something.
Hey. I'm proud of you.
Here's a question. This actually comes up quite a bit.
Space.
Operation Pitchfork.
Oh, yeah.
Are there any special writings going on which deal with Operation Pitchfork contingencies?
Oh, about like when that's going to like go down and the effects of that?
Yeah, I guess.
We're
still quite a ways away.
We are still quite a ways away, and it's been fun watching the Pitchfork community develop and change and grow over my time here, and thinking about how like that's kind of bundled into all the ways that we look at how our players going to be able to affect the game universe on a larger scale. Like, outside of their individual actions, like, when groups of players band together, what kind of change can they expect to affect, like, on the economy, on resources, on, like, military action? And so, as we're building out the narrative for the Persistent Universe, we kind of think of not, like, a linear story, but as kind of, we give these options on what might happen, and then we see how the players might react to it. So, like, recently we just had a Tavarin run for Senate for the first time. So that's been,
right?
Yeah. And so kind of taking that as an example, if we applied it to the PU, it would be like, all right, how can we let the players influence, like, an election like that? Like, would they be cutting off, reserves to one side or the other? If crime goes one way, does that affect the candidate somehow? If there's all these outlaws performing in the system, and how does that all tie into the awesome kind of procedural managers that Tony Z and his team are building out in the subsumption task? So there's a lot of fun, complicated discussions happening.
Gotcha. I'm sorry, did you have something clever?
Oh, no, I was just listening. That's pretty intricate, especially having to deal with not really knowing the full outcomes of people's actions.
Yeah, so hopefully we have a lot of leeway to make the world feel kind of alive and see.
How do you... Oh, I'm sorry, continue.
No.
I'm sorry. Actually, let me jump in here with a correction. When we were talking about the Carrick, if I said it's on the list to start this week, like some people are saying, I meant this year. So I'm pretty sure I said this year. I have no idea if Twitch chat is trolling me or not. But
asterisk.
Regardless of whatever I said, it's on the list to start this year. Man, there's quite a lot of year left.
I am not paying attention to what I'm actually doing in this game.
So we have another question. Can you describe your level of involvement on mission design? Are there any favorites you can talk about without giving specifics?
For the kind of 3.0 stuff, we've been working pretty closely with Luke Presley and his team on figuring out that round and Todd Pappy. Hey, Todd Pappy.
Hey, Todd Pappy.
Director.
Hi, Todd Pappy.
Big fan of the show, Todd Pappy.
Am I going to die here? I'm hacking. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Oh, I did it. Yeah, we have the setting, and we kind of pitch what would be kind of appropriate in that area, and then design comes up with a bunch of ideas, basically usually more mechanic-based, on, hey, we want to do something where you have to go to these three stations and touch them all, like, in their parts. And we then take that, and we try to skin it in, like, that would be really cool. We know we have this gang that we want attacking this area, so maybe they've taken it over, and then you have to go set it free or reset it, or what if you're on the other side of that and you can be hired by the outlaws to be the one who deactivates. So we like to be pretty involved and kind of opening to just not only providing ideas but taking the mechanics and trying to add some sparkle on top of them.
You guys heard that, right? That wasn't just me.
Yeah,
that wasn't just all right. Move along.
There's nothing to hear here.
A big part of Star Citizen is touching space stations and all of the parts.
As far as any specifics, as far as missions in 3.0, I'm going to encourage you to tune in to Citizens of the Stars on Monday, where Sneak Peek, our Quantum Questions guest, is Will Weissbaum here, and he was asked just that question.
Wait, I got to turn chat on. I just saw Dave Haddock. Lead writer Dave Haddock is in the game with us.
Is he on our team?
Yeah, he's playing with me.
No way, bro team.
Awesome. Hey, Dave.
I got to type a little message to him.
I don't know what that was that just happened to my voice there. Hey, Dave. Golly, shucks, Dave.
You found the fountain of youth. That's what happened.
We had a question about the Artemis. What's going on with the Artemis? Is it ever going to be findable?
Wouldn't that be interesting? For those not in the know, the Artemis is part of a lore. It's a ship that was equipped with an AI pilot, and it was sent slow-boating out into the universe. All the humans on board were put into deep sleep, and the idea was that this AI would fly them to a neighboring star system. And unfortunately, things went wrong, and we haven't heard contact from the ship. So it's kind of gone, and that was one of the big reasons why AI hasn't taken off quite as a popular means of control in Star Citizen. It's out there.
That's going to be interesting.
Maybe. Maybe it's destroyed. Maybe
chat,
it's all in pieces.
I refuse to ask him if Tessa Bannister is single.
Oh, God.
Nope.
She will remain single.
Always single.
That was a fun example of us working with design is, like, we had the idea, like, there was all these wrecks that you were supposed to explore, and we were kind of like, all right, how can you find out about them? Like, and we wanted to leave it open in order to be able to find other interesting things, and so we created her as kind of this fun guy to give a little bit of flavor to finding these black boxes and exploring these wrecks. So it ended up working out really well, and the actress did a fantastic job. Mm-hmm. So,
all right, that's a good idea. Instead, I'll ask you if she's married.
That's also inappropriate. You can't ask that. Like, HR is going to have you.
All right, Michael, you got another question on your list.
I do. Oh, yeah. I have a giant question. And that particular question is, so, I mean, the galaxy is huge. And we have Stan, we have Earth, we've got where Damian is. We have all these places. Like, how is the culture broken down? Like, I'm sure there's cultures of each planet. But if you were to meet somebody from, let's say, the Saturn system, like, oh, they're from Saturn, so they're going to behave in XYZ manner. Like, do we have cultures like that, or is it still very much like we all kind of are humans?
It's a little bit of both, actually. Because we have pretty good communication across systems. Like, even when systems are remote, because we don't have real-time interstellar communications, like you have to send comm drones in order to talk to someone through a jump point. There's a little bit of information lag and isolation that way, but for the most part, there's a lot of commerce going back and forth, and so information does get spread. So no one's living in pure isolation, and we all came from the same diaspora of Earth. So there is some stuff that people have in common, but like you said, like living in different environments, dealing with different local situations have given that. We've been working a lot with the character art team on kind of setting up how the different looks of people can be changed based on where they're from. And so we have some interesting ideas from the character art team on that, so that you might be able to look and see someone in a particular jacket or with a particular style about them and be like, oh, that looks like they're from GOS 3. Right now, our NPC behaviors, we're looking more at kind of higher level stuff right now before we get into the specifics of differentiating, like, this guy on this planet talks differently than someone on this planet, because it starts getting very specific and kind of cuts down on some of the stuff. So right now we're focusing on kind of our initial first pass, which is populating the universe on a grand scale of getting, like, the kind of frontier type people, the rough, gruff people you might expect to find at a mining station, and then the more kind of urbanite people and, like, the outlaws versus fancy pants and all those kind of, like, archetypes that could be applied across the empire first. And then we can populate all of it kind of at once. And then from there, our next, like, V2, as we like to say in the development, like the next version, then we'll start getting more specific. Like, what is this guy on this station talking about how, like, the ice cream used to be better 3 years ago? And getting kind of really narrow down content after we can kind of do the whole thing.
Two things I want to point out. One, Will Weissbaum casually dropped diaspora in conversation. And I happen to know what that word means, so I appreciate that.
Oh, okay.
I'm not going to tell you what it means.
Aww.
But no. It's larger populations that came from smaller populations, right?
Oh, okay.
Indeed, you're correct. Like, small, ice cream is confirmed.
Yeah, it's like a small... and also people are giving Stanton crap in chat now.
Oh, what's wrong with Stanton?
Stanton snobs.
Oh, I see. Did you guys see that cool map on ATV yesterday?
Oh, yes. If you haven't seen ATV from yesterday, check that out, guys. The very first kind of top-down, rough positioning map of the Stanton system. You have to freeze frame because you only get to see the full thing for
but the massive scale on it, like,
only
how much
gave
you have
a
to
little
zoom
snippet
in.
Of it.
Yeah.
Damn.
When you see, like, what you currently have around Crusader compared to where it's going, it's a little bit flabbergasting. It's wonderful.
So what have you got, Clifford? What else you got?
Well, I'm kind of curious of in the lore, like, say us as a player, like me, I'm wanting to be a very entrepreneur, and I do really well for myself. Will eventually players themselves, like, in an entrepreneur aspect, kind of build a name for themselves inside the lore if they really, like, control a lot of the industry, so to speak, of planetary trade?
We're still exploring how much that's going to be effective. The idea is that as you build your reputation, more people will be likely to trust you and give you better deals and maybe recognize you on site. It starts getting complicated when the scale we're talking about for NPCs to be able to audibly mention you by name. So that's kind of a tall order when we're talking about as many players as we are. But being impressed by you and kind of speaking on a more generic level is definitely something we've talked about. Kind of what does it mean when you become, like, the best hauler out there, you know, and everyone wants to give you the contract or offer you a better deal or you can charge more for your services. I'm going to get shot in the head right here. I hacked it. Sweet.
Nice work.
I don't know how that happened.
We had a question or two about the next concept sale. I'm going to go ahead and confirm to you that the Hurricane is the next concept sale, and that it is coming a week from today.
Awesome.
So the Hurricane will go on sale a week from today. I don't have the price yet. So I actually can't give you the price because I don't know the price.
We have been working. I will also say here today that the narrative team has been working on the brochure. And it's pretty cool.
Yeah. So brochure for it. Awesome.
So the process of pricing these things is above my pay grade, and it gets quite a few people involved and stuff like that. So that when that is hammered out, we will share that with you, the community. But the Hurricane is the next concept sale, and it will go on sale next Friday.
I'm just apologizing to Dave and Game Chat here for giving away all our secrets. Yep.
Trade secrets.
And let's see, what else do we got here in the chat? Somebody asked if there's going to be any lore about the frost line.
We have mentioned the frost line. I specifically used the term frost line in this month's Galactic Guide coming out in Jump Point today.
Ooh.
So, I think, yeah. So I don't know if there's something more than, like, do you mean, like, do solar systems have frost lines? The answer is yes.
Yes.
We've been working with our consultants to kind of calculate what is a reasonable distance based on which class of stars in a system. And so we have, like, the green zones and the frost lines and try to make sure that the planets line up with where they're supposed to be in a system because of science. So something that's been interesting happening to me as I started working on this project, getting more vested in space news, is seeing how much every week a new story comes out of, like, hey, that thing that we all said was impossible, well, we found it. It's here. It's not impossible. We were wrong.
Dave was talking about that.
That's a good point, you bringing up the news, because we will have, you know, Reliant News Van. Will players' news also maybe play a part in some of the lore if we report it? You think it would be tossed in there as coverage?
I think it's a bit too early to say. I think that's as far as intentions go, you know, that's definitely something we'd like to investigate and like to look at. It's always, you know, in game development, it's always you have all these ideas, all these things that you'd love to do. It's a question of time and resources and technical capabilities.
Yeah, will it be featured on TVs in the verse? Will it be the kind of thing on your Mobi where you get to see, like, people posting in the local area? Like, there's a couple, like, ways it could go if we can pull it off. There's some neat stuff. So hopefully, you know, we have the awesome news van. Yeah. So it'll be great to see.
Basically, it's not a question that can be answered until we cross that bridge.
Sounds cool on sounds cool on paper, but it might be missing on implementation.
But of course, as with everything, we will endeavor to do all that we can.
But maybe you're going on your stream on Beam and using your Reliant to cast there.
Yeah. Now, we have a couple questions. We have a couple questions in the chat. Folks who weren't here at the beginning, they're seeing a lot of unfamiliar faces.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to go right around and do the intros. Well, guys, tell everybody who you are. I'm Community Manager Jared Huckaby.
I'm Michael. I'm QA from Austin.
No. What? Try again.
Michael.
My identity has been stolen.
ID theft is a real problem. I'm Will Weissbaum, senior writer over here in Los Angeles. How's it going?
Hi there. I'm Will Weissbaum. I'm a senior writer here in Los Angeles.
He turned it around on me.
Sorry, the door is revolving. But I am Michael Blackard. I am QA here in Austin for Real Real, not for Play.
Clifford?
I'm Clifford, a.k.a. Miku, just a nobody. No, I'm just
he's the first somebody. You are somebody to everybody. Yeah.
Well, people first know me from StarCast, and then from StarCast to the base, and then from the base, I stream solely on Beam now. But I am still part of the redacted community and still try and contribute in my own way amongst Beam now. So,
We have a question. I know the redactor and the merchantman are being on the schedule to be worked on. Can we see some interior concept art? If you subscribe to our weekly newsletter that goes out every Friday, maybe it was 2 weeks ago?
Some stuff.
There was some brand new interior concept art of the Banu merchantman. And when I mean brand new, I mean it came in and we went right into the newsletter.
I'm a gun stuck.
So it is brand new. So you can check that out if you missed it on the newsletter. It was in there for 2 weeks ago. It's since been taken and put on, you know, the forums and Reddit and stuff like that. So you can find it if you search for it. But sneak peeks, for those of you who've wondered, like, where they went from ATV, they are in the weekly newsletter. Now. So check out that weekly newsletter. Check your spam filters. There's lots of fun stuff that goes out there.
I gotta say, you know, having played with the grenade indicators and now going back to playing without the grenade indicators,
I'm having fun surprises.
Huge time. I wanted to change out my loadout, and that's something in 2.6.1, and it's just.
I, I keep killing myself in my own damn grenade. I just did it on the steps.
Yes.
I'm getting bodied.
Whoa, I'm in third place.
Work. I'm doing really well this game.
How is this?
Damn, Disco. Damn, second place.
Oh, we lost.
I got second place in
we
history.
Lost Dave.
No. Oh, bye, Dave. Hey, Tyler. Tyler Nolan is in chat. Tyler Aiken is on vacation day. Tyler Nolan is in chat. Hi, Tyler. Let's see what's going on here. Matachi. Matachi is also in chat. Matachi, I don't appreciate you killing my avatar.
Yeah, he keeps killing me a lot. He's like,
he's
on point. Yeah, Matachi's harder. Right. Kid.
We've got quite a few lore heads in the chat today.
No. Oh, yeah.
Right,
like
now, we have a question.
Of them.
What is the lore behind the Nine Tails, and can we join them?
Well, they. I'm debating like how much to
to
say
indulge.
Right now. Well, the reason why we're always kind of quiet on some stuff is that as much as it's fun to read about this lore, when we start planning on like, oh, are we going
to
be revealing this information
in
the game? It's kind of like we want that fun of discovery. So yes. I'm going to be. Mum on all of that. Right now, we have you being able to kind of ancillarily do jobs for the Ninetales through your contact, Rudo, who sends you those fun messages in the game right now when you play in the PU. So we can hopefully expect some more from the Ninetales and Rudo.
I'm always a fan of destroying their connies in Pirate Storm. Like, that's my jam. It's hard to do, and that's why it's my jam.
Yeah, yep.
But it's fun seeing their stuff in Grim Hex taking over that station.
Okay. Let's see. All right. Can you give an example of Cathcart dialect?
Oh, no. I cannot.
Hello, everybody. My name is Will Weissbaum. I'm from Cathcart.
It's kind of Australian. That is a toughie. That is not something I've mastered yet. Oh, my gun's not working.
I have talk like a Cathcart day.
Come on. Sorry, my gun's not working. I cannot speak in Cathcart.
I'm still majorly interested in somebody making
a... Just melee everybody.
I'm just surprised that... I'm going to be surprised. Somebody in the community is going to come up with a cosplay outfit of a Vandal and put lights in it to make and try and make an actual deal that when they try and speak Vandal language that it'll actually mimic with the lights.
That'd be pretty cool.
That would be really cool.
I've seen the closest thing I've seen to a Vandal as far as somebody doing a suit like that is like the Guyver, and that's an anime type deal, but it's a sci-fi like bio suit.
Yeah, the fun we've been working, you know, a bunch recently with Britain, our linguist who's working on all our languages, and kind of the fun questions that he asks us about stuff that we haven't dove into yet, like just because it's like, well, I need a word for this, it's important, like what is the history behind it, because he always wants it to the word usage to kind of organically emerge from the actual lore of the Xi'an themselves and the other races. So it's really been great to kind of be poked on this stuff and being like, well, we actually hadn't thought about that yet, let's figure that out.
This question's come up in chat a couple times. Why are so many of the bad guys in our game English? Is that a Star Wars thing?
No. That is a studio location thing. A lot of our VO talent is from England. We do a bunch of recording over there, so sometimes that ends up being our talent pool. We do have our fair share of American accents. We have a bunch of kind of other additional voice packs that we're hoping to expand our outlaw pool coming out in 3.0 to kind of start mixing up the voices you hear a bit more.
Yeah, so there's always Daryl over at Kovalex.
Yeah.
Always Daryl.
Yeah, so at this point,
so chipper.
It's more a logistics thing than anything else.
Yeah, we're going to try to have an even spread of a bunch of different kind of voices for you to hear.
Oh, good. Okay.
We'll see about the Cathcart dialect. That is a Dave Haddock special, and it's a wonderful thing that he created that I have just just not even attempted to poke at. It is so fun.
Yeah. I think I started something terrible in chat when I mentioned the Guyver, because I forgot Mark Hamill was in that movie when they came out with it.
Yeah. So a reminder for folks submitting questions in Twitch, our special guest today is a writer and
Hello.
Member of the lore team. So if you're asking questions about the design of the weapon systems, not the guy to talk to about that, unfortunately.
Here, you can ask him, and I can say I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know.
My
so,
weapon.
Here's a question, and I agree with this. This is from Punk Mofo. Hey, Punk Mofo. What's the deal with so many Malloy family members?
Anytime you start with what's the deal, you know you're
what's
for
the
a good
deal?
Team.
What's the deal?
What's the deal with so many Malloy family members?
Malloy family members? Is this a joke I'm not getting? Am I failing my lore
characters
test?
With the last name Malloy.
Huh.
Man, that other team was
really I'm going to have to start like doing word find now. All right, Twitch, who has the last name Malloy? Is that something we're inadvertently doing? One of us might have like a word preference that we don't know
real
about.
Malloy. Clearly, we're trying to find the real Malloy.
Well, we'll put a pin in that. We'll do some research and come back next come out next week on Happy Hour. I'll see if I have an answer for you.
Now I'm like racking my brain. I was like, is that something? Because you tend to have like preferences like that you try to,
absolutely.
Which is great why we always read each other's writing to kind of catch that being like, oh, you're using the name Janus again. Like we have five Januses. Yeah,
like Hanzo Malloy owns Koblex.
Oh.
All right. So what are we playing next?
Yeah.
So what are we playing next? So this is Star like? Marine. I think we should do some Arena Commander.
Oh.
Let's do it.
Okay.
All right.
Someone want to invite me again?
I shall. Do we want to be on team? You know what? Let's do this one.
Yeah, let's do some PvE. We were doing Vendor Swarm before. Let's do some PvE, some team PvP. Or some team VP. Team VP? I'm not in English.
All right, so let's do Pirate Swarm since we were talking about the
Ninetales.
The foxes.
Yeah.
Oh,
that'd
you're
going to
do
awesome.
Pirate Swarm? Okay.
Fine. Do you want to do that in multiplayer or do you want to make it private?
Make a multiplayer because you don't want to have to
let's
just go with three
do
people.
It.
Let's get another person in there.
Yeah.
You got it ready up.
Oh, I got it ready.
I just invited folks. So
2.6
1
has
you're
the
not
new
in the
back out.
Did Clifford Marine?
Yeah.
Or
yeah.
Clifford invite? Okay. So back out because you're in two separate games at this point.
Oh, okay. Let me back out. Okay.
So everybody back out to the main menu and then I'll re-invite you.
Yeah. Michael is running invites.
Really, kudos to Trevor and Zane, by the way, for these new beautiful UI.
And
menus.
They're even better in 2.6.1. 2.6.1 has even more additional.
I was just clicking that ready, not ready, and the improve that one. It's got a little checkbox.
Yeah.
Now, so that's
let me
easier.
Get out of Arena Commander for some reason.
No.
I know you can't answer this, but I'm going to ask it anyway just to see what you do.
Okay.
Will there be a big universe secret?
Yes.
One second here.
No, I don't.
Let me restart.
It's so secret, no one will ever find out.
Do you also write lore on the behavior of the fauna?
Yes. Bit. The flora and fauna has been coming along as the environment's been working more on the procedural planets. I think we just showed off some sweet cacti recently. That's been pretty cool. So a lot of times that's spearheaded by the artist for a majority of times when they're creating a look and a feel for a planet or trying to figure out. But, you know, we've had some kind of discussions for 3.0 in terms of populating possibly some of the worlds there and what are we going to do and trying to figure out, all right, what makes sense in this ecological bubble? So we kind of help spawn ideas.
Like the Malloy cactus.
The Malloy cactus.
Okay, I'm going to cancel it because two of us are in Stalkers and I don't know if that's what you actually want to be in.
Okay.
Oh, I didn't change my ship, but that's fine.
Yeah, I forgot to change my ship, too, and I was just like, I can't be
so back out?
No, don't back out. I'll re-invite you.
Somebody asks, do the writers have the best job at CIG? I'm going to go ahead and say no, because I have the best job
at CIG. That's some bias right there.
No, allow me to be a little
bias?
A little touchy-feely here. But woohoo. getting to go to events, getting to go to Bar Citizens, getting to meet most of you people. I won't say all. Let's be real. But getting to meet most of you people.
You hear him?
I wouldn't trade this job for anything in the world. I think I have the best job at CIG.
Yeah, because you think about it, you know, I think, and maybe y'all can speak from personal experience from SIG itself, is that y'all seem to get, like, when we have a CitizenCon and you, everybody, the actual, all the creators are there able to actually get direct feedback, hugs, you know, thank yous, that it really gives them like that extra oomph when they go back to work every day. And you're pretty lucky, Lando, that you get to get more of that because you're out in the field a lot of the times, basically.
Yeah. Okay, no. Now you guys have started in on that Red One stuff. I don't have the best job at the CIG anymore.
You've ruined it.
Besides,
I'm on Aurora One.
Besides Hansel Molloy, who owns Koblex.
Are we getting also, all the Molloys?
There's also, I'm just thinking about it. There's Janice Molloy, she's like a historian. She's like a racing historian. One of the racing historians had a Janice Molloy. And I think there's at least one more.
This is really fascinating to me. Okay, this is great. We'll try to get to the bottom of the mystery.
I feel like there's a Molloy test pilot or something.
I'm going to go back to the job thing and just advocate for my particular role, because that's where Tyler came from and that's where I'm from. And because QA has allowed me to flex a lot of my skills, from video editing to just testing things, and I ran into a wall and helping you guys out with the December live stream because I've been in theater and in ballet and all these other things for all my life, like, I get to flex all these different muscles that you may not be able to get to in a normal job
role. All of the muscles.
Are you doing ballet things under the table right now that we can't see?
Yeah, I actually write ballets. I actually participate. I dance. I do all that kind of stuff.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Been doing it for about 15 or something years. I'm not professional, so let's not get crazy.
Well, that ballet is no joke, though. It takes a lot of freaking muscle down there to be able to pull off some of those moves.
I definitely don't have the best job at CIG anymore.
So speaking of the arts and things of that sort, like, how has martial arts evolved in our universe?
That is also going to be determined heavily by design. Ooh, I killed someone. We've been kind of waiting for the melee stuff to come online before we start diving into that specific that much. Right.
Gotcha. Somebody in chat put a list of Molloys, but you guys keep typing and it keeps moving around. Okay, so Hansel Molloy owns Koblex.
I seen it.
Yark Badger Molloy is a MISC in-house test pilot.
Oh.
Helena Molloy Vasquez is first mate of the Starfarer Sunshine Tree. And Dr. Jave Molloy is a racing historian.
Oh.
Huh.
So yeah.
So they're very diverse.
At least four Molloys.
This is legit.
Very diverse.
This is awesome. Okay. I learned something here today. We're gonna find out.
We've accomplished something good here today.
Maybe they are all related. Maybe there is like a Molloy family plot. Maybe.
Or maybe it's a new
could
Smith.
Be.
Yeah.
How many Chris's are there on staff?
A lot, and
Tyler's.
Probably about there's about 15, I think. The last time I counted, there's about 15 Chris's between the four studios.
Holy crap! Really?
We're growing,
man.
So much that every name pretty much has like someone else. Like there's a bunch of Wills now.
Are there any other Michaels? I'm kind of
curious, Lando. What are y'all gonna do when y'all, you know, the empty space where you do all these shows? What happens if y'all have to take up that space next?
We'll cross that bridge when we get there. I try not to think about it. So, okay. So here's the thing. Hey guys, as a writer, how do you feel about pilots? Let's say who is, chat's scrolling here. Can we turn off the auto scroll on Twitch? Is that possible? How do you feel about pilots who, I'm trying to see. You guys, when you ask the long questions, it's hard because I keep scrolling past it. Who are transporting cargo and a freelancer and come across distress beacons. Do distress beacon missions... No, I'm sorry. It keeps going by. You asked a long question. Make a shorter question, and I'll try to read it.
I mean, are you going to be able to come across like people in distress and decide what to do? I think that's going to be a big part. It's kind of something we talked about. Like one of our characters, Old Jaeger, who writes Far From Home. You know, he kind of talks about that community of people who are out on the black and how important it is to help each other out there. And that's kind of, I think, a nice sense of community about these people who are maybe running along the less populated flight lanes. And if you get in trouble out in the middle of space, you're really in trouble. So it's kind of one of those rules of the road that you should probably stop and help if you see someone in need.
Yeah, yeah. I know that normally you scroll up and chat stops scrolling, but that is not the case right now. I'm on a Chromebook for the thing, and maybe it's something for the Chromebook, but it keeps resetting to the beginning. So let's see, what else we got? will we see robots or drones do basic functions on ships? We have a repair bot.
Yep.
We have a repair bot. That's one of the stretch goal rewards.
Yep.
AMX-1.
It's been a while. Yeah. So, yeah, we have repair drones and, like, you know, possibly, like other kind of menial works have been tossed around as possibilities, like cargo handling or, like, you know, we have, important part is the hand artisanal floor cleaning, so we don't want to lose that. Like, mopping by hand is important.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, maybe some places don't care about that level of craftsmanship in getting their floors clean. So maybe they would have, like, an automated floor
military
cleaner.
Is still going to have janitors and stuff because, you know, you don't want to rely on technology too much.
Well, isn't also sometimes the janitors are also the mechanics?
We have, they do kind of basic internal service functions as well as kind of the more the custodial stuff. So vary on ship and crew size about how specialized they get. The less people you have, the more multiple kind of roles they would be expected to pull.
Here's a good one. There's a question that they asked Dave last week. Do you prefer writing for good guys or bad guys? What's more fun for you?
That is a good question.
Yeah, that is a really good one.
I think I'm leaning more recently towards writing for good guys. It kind of varies with what I've been doing recently, but... you know, like, we have a lot of stories with high action and, like, shooting and outlaws and stuff like that. So, like, trying to find these moments of hope and inspiration, like we were talking about, like, Far From Home. Like, that's kind of fun for me, of putting that kind of role-playing spin on stuff.
Gotcha. I think Dave answered bad guys.
Yeah, he's really good at it.
I'm always a fan of the morally ambiguous... Sure, they're bad at 5 o'clock, but what about 6?
I'm
I just hope that old lady with her groceries.
Well, it's a 9 to 5 evil.
Yeah, 9 to 5 evil.
Here's a personal question for you. On doing the lore and everything, have you ever thought about, or is there in the works maybe in the future, because everybody in Star Wars loves Darth Vader as a bad guy. Is there somebody going to be prevalent in Star Citizen that we actually fall in love with, like Darth Vader, basically? You think?
Huh.
We'll have to just wait and see.
I would say there's no predicting that. There are certainly characters you're going to hope people fall in love with.
Well, that's the thing, is that a lot of times it's really hard to predict who is going to hit home. Like, we try to make every character fun and interesting. Tessa, for example,
Tessa
was kind
was
of
nothing.
A surprise hit. And then, like, you go... with someone, so I think there's going to be a lot of room for people to discover the characters that they have fun with, and I think because there's going to be also a lot of times in the game this kind of focus on seeing the difference between the micro stories and the macro stories, like, who is this guy, like a big operator in Stanton system and has like this small territory under control and he's big shot there. But if you go a system over, no one really has heard about them. And so like that's different than versus kind of the more Imperial wide figures who, you know, like Imperator Costigan or something that you'd be seeing news about across the whole thing. So I think there's going to be hopefully a lot of people that... players can attach themselves to and kind of enjoy and meet.
Okay.
How do you like to go about writing all of this? Like, do you have an idea and all of a sudden you're like, I'm writing all the things? Or is it like you have a sketch pad and tons of ideas and all of a sudden you just pick one? Like, how do you go about writing?
Well, on the day-to-day, it's often kind of a bit of a squeaky wheel thing that we have our priorities are constantly pulling us in different directions and it's about just sitting down like, this is... what I need to write now, but we kind of do long-term planning and high-level planning and trying to get our stuff that we're passionate about out into the verse for people to enjoy. And that kind of difference of working on the specific gameplay stuff as well as kind of all the fun short story type stuff we get to do with the weekly news updates and the jump points. That it's been, in the past we've had jump points where we've brought in outside authors to do short stories for us, but as an editor team we decided to kind of take it in-house for the past several issues. So Adam did a great story about the second T'Varn War.
It's an all right story.
I really enjoyed it. And
don't get a big head, Adam.
And then we got to do a fun kind of in universe lore piece about a TV show called Law Squad. So that was fun. And then Dave just started a new story called Drifters, which is, it's great to have Dave back writing one of these longer pieces again, because he's really good at it, and my boss, but he's really good.
And so your boss.
I feel like I'm upselling Jump Point a lot. But
Jump Point. Benefit for
Jump Point is awesome.
But these stories, you know, they're a great way to kind of flesh out what we hope that the game's going to feel like once you get into these worlds. Like,
I actually have a question for Jared. Jared, how do you go about like setting up your work? Because I mean, you're all over the place. You're doing this and you're doing these other streams and you're preparing for these events that are like later and months down the road. Like, how do you go about like structuring your day?
Is a day allowed to have structure?
I mean,
no, I'm a, one of the things that I've referred to besides a Swiss Army knife is like human fix a flat. Basically, I'm just the guy, they spray me into a situation, I go wherever the
the
holes are. Yeah, I go where I'm needed. So if it's video production, it's video production. If it's live stream stuff, it's live stream stuff. If it's sales post, it's sales post. Yesterday I was writing up our big 261 post for when that releases, and working with Turbulent, writing up, you know, Spectrum how-tos and stuff like that. It's wherever wherever I can help. There isn't much structure. I've done artwork for our game box and stuff, so the box, when that comes out, you know, we'll have artwork that I've created for the thing. It's I go wherever, you know, we're still a small company for 300 and some odd people. We're still a young small company, so we don't have everybody for every single thing that needs to be done. So a lot of working here is filling in other places. And
yeah, I mean, I still have to press the keys on my keyboard myself. I don't have anyone to do that for me yet. So.
Well, I think Lando, you one thing you said time again, since you have done so many jobs, I think that's your strength, is that you're able to wear many hats at SIG.
Well, if I wore many hats, they wouldn't be this dirty. No, but yeah, it's I fill in. I work wherever I'm needed. So it's 1 month is, there hasn't been, in the 2 years I've been here now, there hasn't been a week that was like the week before it, or a week that was like the week after it. So, I have a question for you.
Oh yeah,
this
please.
Is serious.
This is, yeah.
I'm deadly serious on this. Who would win in a fight, Imperator Castigan, or Messer?
What kind of fight?
Mixed martial arts.
I'd have to say, in which Messer are we talking? The original old school?
Yeah, the
Ivar
original
Messer?
Old school Messer.
Okay, so I think Ivar Messer. He's got that military combat training, which I don't believe Costigan got his citizenship through service, but I'm gonna have to double check that now that I said that out loud. But I'd have to put my money on.
Okay.
I can't seem to respawn, so yep. I'm gonna go to this camera.
Now, what if they were fighting in a match of Bop It?
Like the pass back and forth, yes. Childhood game.
Yeah.
Did you see they have a new version that came out where it's on your head?
No.
Really?
Yeah.
What? That's crazy.
Oh no, that was Simon. I totally lied.
Oh man. Okay. There we go.
I would put it down onto Ivar Messer. I'm sorry.
I am.
Sorry, Imperator Costigan. I'm trying.
Don't be sorry for being right.
I was hoping you were going to say, like Dave Malloy.
You keep picking contests that are based on quick reflexes, like Bop It, when you have to switch from twist it to flick it. Like, that's like matter
that
of fractions of seconds.
That was hardcore stuff.
Okay. All right, back to the real questions.
Okay.
How challenging is it to write for procedural or branching mission chains?
Oh, very, very hard. That's one of the big challenges that we face in, you know, Squadron 42 and the PU content. And it's like covering a broad of situation. It's always a balancing act of, like, you can think of thousands of things that might happen, but you can't write that many lines and conceivably be expected to get recorded and implemented and do it for multiple voices. So then you kind of try to categorize them in together. So like, oh, when the player does this kind of things, these four lines would be appropriate responses to it. And then the more branching you have, you have to decide whether you're going to have allow different outcomes or whether it's going to feed back into themselves. So that you can guarantee that players will wind up back at the same place.
I'm here.
And then we start getting more into
yes!
kind of the procedural snippets, which we've been exploring a lot more with the 3.0 development of
heal thyself.
Kind of taking pieces of character and dialogue that can work in a system where the kind of our manager system is telling what's going to happen next. Like we're creating like a piece of cargo that needs to be taken here. When that mission's created, what are the lines that cover you being informed about it and kind of the puzzle pieces that go into creating that? It's been a real fun challenge, and hopefully we'll get to show that stuff off more coming up.
Gotcha. Now, one of awesome. The common one of the common rules in scripts, at least for movies, is that it's a page a minute. It's a page a minute. Obviously, that goes out the window with branching scripts a bit. How many pages was did the Squadron 42 script end up at?
We're still growing, but
I was about to say, Mike, I'm pretty sure that's still being worked on.
well, now one thing that we've kind of been working on now is on-screen text needs for Squadron 42, which is a whole another can of worms of like all the text that you'll be able to read in your Mobi Glass and mission text and all that kind of stuff. So we're kind of organizing that right now. But we were over 1,200 pages at the last count. And that page a minute, when you have pages, because that average is based off of having action and dialogue on the same page, so it kind of changes a bit. We have a lot of pages when we get into these wild lines or branching where it's just all dialogue for a solid page as someone says, you know, where are you going or come over here a couple different ways and times. So
I imagine part of what you're still working on is also wild lines, things for like background characters, not anything that's to the story or whatnot, but you know, the things that you would encounter as you're walking down the hall of an Idris or something, stuff that goes on.
Yeah, filling in some of the NPC stuff as well as, you know, as we do play tests, there's invariably like these little holes that you'll discover that you didn't quite think of. And so it's kind of figuring out pickups or kind of patching in, like the player needs this extra bit of information. It's a little confusing. How do we smooth that out for them, make the experience better? Can we do that in dialogue? Do we do it with on text? Can we do it with environment art? Is a lot of the best solution sometimes of letting the players figure stuff out themselves, but just giving them hints. So it's kind of looking at that sort of stuff now.
Yeah, and
keeps it organic.
That's it. And just to confirm, that 1,200 pages is just episode one.
That is
holy crap.
Just episode one. All right, guys. With that is the end of our broadcast. So
already?
How far?
Already?
Yeah, that's been an hour. How far are you guys?
Dang, go.
We're fast. That's right. So I want to thank Clifford, a.k.a. Miku.
Happy birthday again.
Happy birthday. We have to sing for him.
We already do it. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
All right, that's it. All right, so Clifford, you're gonna be streaming at the conclusion of this on your channel on Beam.
Yes.
If I'm not mistaken. Why don't you tell folks what that channel is?
Yes, it's beam.pro/Clifford_aka_Miku, and also the mods have posted in Twitch chat. If y'all weren't able to grab it, we can put it in there.
And we're gonna give you a Star Citizen and Squadron 42 combo package with a Hornet to give away.
Wow!
So you can give that away
thank
on
you.
Your stream.
Awesome,
Michael, yes. Thank you so much for filling in for Tyler this week.
You all are so more than welcome. I hope I get to all see you again.
Yeah,
that would be great.
Come on out. It was good having you here last year, at the end of the year.
We'll get you a new shirt.
That whole time.
Will?
Oh, my gosh. A third shirt? I don't know that I can contain my excitement for that.
Oh, you're trying to wrap it up.
Will?
Wrap it up.
Yeah. We will see you on Quantum Questions on Monday. How do you think you're going to do?
What do you mean? I know how I did.
Oh, you mean it's already pre-taped?
Oh, no. It's live. Wait, no, are we selling it that way?
It's movie magic, man. Movie magic.
So I confused. Crises happening right
Will
now.
Leverett, check him out on Quantum Questions on Monday. We'll have a little snippet on social media this week, and I think we got a nice little outtake that I think you're going to enjoy. Answer some questions about the hurricane coming up, and Quest Givers in 3.0, so check that out. And, of course, I'm Jared Huckaby, one of the community managers here for Star Citizen. Thank you for tuning in for Happy Hour. We certainly appreciate you taking the time out of your day to join us each and every week.
Thank you guys so much. Thanks for having me.
So for Clifford, for Michael, for Will, and for Jared. See you later, everybody.
Bye, guys.